live acoustical stuff. Are you enjoying it?
Amen. Amen.
3, 4, 5, 6.
Amen.
You know, and that one song that we sang, the song we sang during the one we sang prior to offering, it's a new song for us. The title of the song that we sang in worship was called 10,000 Reasons. And, you know, I found the words of that song to be very powerful this morning, and I so much so that I would like to read maybe the first 3 or 4 lines of that song as we sang it. The first few lines of that song, 10,000 Reasons, it says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." Does anybody know that psalm, by the way? It's like Psalm 104, Psalm 105. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." Amen. We're going to talk about that today. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before." I like that. "Sing like never before, O my soul." You ever say that to your soul lately? You ever wake up and say, "Soul, you better sing like never before. I will worship your holy name." Oh, I love the next lines. "The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning." Anybody need a new day sometimes? You know, sometimes you just want to get rid of yesterday, right? Sometimes there's a lot of yesterdays we want to get rid of, right? God, I just need one yesterday, God. I need a whole lot of yesterdays. That's why the soul has to rise up inside of us and say, "Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul." You know, our soul must realize there is a new day that is dawning. Amen? Yeah, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Is that how you rise every morning? Yeah. Sometimes that's how we need to wake up. "Hey, it's time to sing again. I just heard the alarm clock go off." Now, I know it's a stretch for some of us. "Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes." Amen. We'll start the day singing. We'll end the day singing. You know, it's really very much something that I believe God is dealing with us as of late in regard to our soul singing a new song. And Brother Vince, it seems like you're always here at just the right times, you know? Because, you know, it's always a blessing to see you walk in the door, Brother Vince. You bless me, you bless this house, you know that. And every time I see Vince, I'm always reminded of a new day, of new life, of new things that God is doing. So, you know, even if you would, why don't you open up your Bibles with me? And maybe I'd like to start with the psalm. Let's turn to Psalm, maybe 102. I'll tell you what, we'll turn to Psalm 104. We'll start there. If you're not there, I'll read to you. I think I'm going to start with the 103rd Psalm. The 103rd Psalm, Psalm 103, it says something like we just said earlier. Psalm 103 says, I don't like this translation. I have the NIV. It says, "Praise the Lord," but who has the King James Version? "Bless the Lord, oh my soul." Oh, thanks, Pastor. I need King James. Psalm 103. Thank you. Okay, "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." You know, sometimes you got to say that a few times before you listen to yourself and start doing it, right? Because sometimes it's just words out of our mouth with nothing connected to it. You know, sometimes we can talk and not really be connected to our words, right? But if you connect yourselves to those words, you really have to start making some changes in our lives, you know? "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all," not just some, "all that is within me, bless his holy name." Verse 2 says it again, just like God knows, you know, God knows. Verse 2 says it again, okay. "Bless the Lord, oh my soul." Guess what it says after that? "And forget not his benefits," all his benefits. Go on. "Who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies." Verse 5, go ahead, Felicia. "Who satisfies your mouth with good things. So that your youth is renewed like eagles. Come on now, give the Lord a hand. Come on. Come on now. This is the word of the Lord to you today. This is not a speech that gets you feeling good. It's the words of God that tells you you are good, that He is good, and everything is all right. This is the words of God, of our Heavenly Father, to His loving children. He says to His children, I created you, I gave you birth, I put breath in your lungs, and I chose you to live this life. And He says, the life I chose for you is good. It's your Father. It's your Father speaking to you. Do you think your Father created you for misery? Tell me no. Tell me no. Verse 5, Felicia led the way, but verse 5, it says, who satisfies your mouth with what?
Good things.
So that your youth is renewed in life. Anybody want some of that? Some of you say, I don't need some of that. I got some of that. I'm all right. Okay. Amen. Amen. I like this Bible, Pastor Bill. It's a nice leather. This is, yeah. Thanks, I think I shall. I'll give you mine.
Pastor Mike.
Okay, good. I'll use that later. Okay, Psalm 105. Psalm 104. Take a wild guess how 104 might start. Ready?
Bless the Lord.
Oh! Oh my goodness. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh Lord my God, you are very
great.
Mm-hmm. You are clothed with honor and, you guys there? Majesty. You cover yourself with light as a garment. Who stretched out the heavens like a curtain? He lays the beams of his upper chambers in the waters. Who makes the clouds his what? His chariot. Who walks on the wings of the wind. Who makes his angels, hey, you're included here. Who makes his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. Verse 5. You who laid the foundations of the earth so that it may not be moved forever. Who is this? Your God. Who is this? My God. Hallelujah. In that short passage there, the Lord told us three times what we're encouraged to. Bless the Lord, O my
soul,
and all that is within me. Bless His holy name.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Amen. Amen. Do you know those simple words and those simple psalms, that is the plan of all of salvation and redemption. Do you know that? Do you know that Jesus Christ, the lover of your soul, God Himself took on the form of flesh so that He'd die on a cross for you and for me? Amen? Uh-huh. To save your soul and to save my soul. To save the soul of all mankind. What is your soul and my soul? Your soul is just the inside of you. It's the invisible part of you, but it's the very real part of you. I know sometimes we look at each other, we just see the flesh and blood. We see a lot of natural things, and sometimes we make judgments according to that. But that's not even the real me, and it's not even the real you. Some of us are grateful for that, right? Amen. No, I look a wreck. Don't look at me, I look a wreck. The real you is the inside of you. It's the part of you that will live forever. It's the part of you that always has lived and always will live. It's the real you. Sometimes a part of you that nobody can see, and sometimes you think nobody understands, but it's the real you. And the God wants to come into the real you. He wants to save the real you. He's not looking to put spit and polish on the outside so that He can dress up and look good on a Sunday. And still on the inside of us have cries and torments and pleas to our God. He wants to come to the inside of you and save the inside of you. Uh-huh. He wants to save the inside of you. So you and I get to a point where the inside of us just automatically says, my soul magnifies the Lord. Where the inside of you starts to say, hey, I feel good and I look good and I am good.
Amen.
Amen to that. God wants to save your soul and my soul. You know, we talked on Wednesday night about the 19th chapter of Revelation. And the first part of Revelation 19, we said there were a certain number of hallelujahs. Remember how many hallelujahs were in there? How many? There were four hallelujahs. Anybody here on Wednesday night remember that?
Yes.
Hallelujah. And then you remember we all sang for a minute?
Yeah.
No, you don't remember that? Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, how many was that?
Four.
Those are the four hallelujahs. Listen, if I'm going to look silly, you have to come and look silly with me, all right? Come on now. Don't leave me out here. I'm trying. There were four hallelujahs in Revelation 19. What was everybody singing hallelujah about? It wasn't Christmas. They were singing hallelujah because Babylon was falling. The short part of it is this. Babylon falling, it's a picture of, it was the soul of man that was finally saved. Because Scripture says the end of your faith is the salvation of your souls. And when our souls are finally saved, there's a four cry, hallelujah, hallelujah. Where the inside of you starts to agree with the very heavens themselves. Where the inside of you starts to say, I am strong. Right? You know passages where it says, let the weak say, I am
strong.
Come on. I'm going to say it again. Let the weak say, I am
strong.
Let the poor say, I am
rich.
How else? Is there any others? It goes on and on. But you see, the inside of you becomes safe and starts to be an expression of all of it. Where your feelings and your emotions and your intellect and your words line up with heaven itself. It's called salvation. Is that all right?
Yes.
And we said on Wednesday that the process of salvation is this. It's when you have to first divorce the old man, or really there has to be a death of an old man and the birth of a new man. It's called being born again, right? An old man has to die, an old world has to end, and a new world has to come into being. Aren't you glad that Jesus Christ, he was the one who died the old death for you. He was the one who took you out of an old world and brought you into a new world. So now we're free. Scripture says when we receive salvation, we're free to marry another. And the other that we're free to marry is Jesus Christ himself. Let me get back to you for a second before I start throwing it around. You see, all too often, the place where we have fell from that God had to redeem us from is this. Our soul was created by God to be an expression of heaven. Do you know that? Do you know that you were created to be an expression of heaven? That's why God puts you on the earth, to express heaven. Scripture says that God is invisible, so he had to put himself in a visible form so you could see what heaven looks like. That's why he created you. Yeah, he created you so everybody could see what heaven and God looks like. They can just look into your eyes and look into your life and say, oh, that's heaven. That's very attractive. Yeah. What has happened is our soul in the fallen place, we no longer became the expression of the heavenly things. We became an expression of the natural earthly things, which God has redeemed us from. See, that the expression, when the soul gives an expression to the naturally earthly things, you look around in the world and what you can see, touch, and feel, things that happen to your body, and then your soul starts to express all that stuff. And that's how you get a world that's filled with all kinds of things, because our soul is not married to the spirit, it's married to our bodies. And now our soul, instead of saying, my soul magnifies the Lord, we say stuff like this, my soul is going to magnify the earth today. And sometimes we look into the earth and we look into our bodies, we talk about this, but we'll continue to. And we say, hey, today I don't feel so good. Today I'm a little poor. Today I'm a little weak. Today I'm a little depressed. Why do we say that? Because our soul is not magnifying the spirit realm anymore. Now our soul is magnifying the earth realm, right? Yeah, you look at the bank account, what do you start to do? Some of you cry. Some of you ain't laughing at that. I'm not laughing now. Some of us look at the bank accounts and we cry because we're looking at the soulless realm, the natural realm, and then we express that realm. But if you look at God, you know what's going to happen? You're going to sing. You're going to say, I was created to be an expression of the heavens, an expression of life and love. Amen. God saving our souls, a picture of this, once again, it's a picture of your soul not be an expression of the earth realm, but your soul be an expression of the heavenly realm. When your soul is an expression of the earth realm, it produces destruction. I'm going to give you an example. You have your Bibles? I'm going to turn to the NIV with this one. Psalm 102. I want to show you something here. Psalm 102. When you live your life, and when I live my life according to a natural realm, according to what you see, feel, and touch, according to the evening news, and what you look around in the earth, what you look in your bank account, you might start to say stuff like David said in Psalm 102. In Psalm 102, David says stuff like this. He says, hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen, before we go any further, listen, he doesn't start off with my soul magnifies the Lord. It seems like he's a little down, right? See, can you get that way? I got six honest ones. Okay. I'm only playing with you. Okay. So he says, hear my prayer, O Lord. He's not singing, is he? Oh, let's look at the next verse. He says, let my cry for help come to you. What happened to our singing? Weren't we having a good time? What happened? David said, hear my prayer, O Lord. Let my cry for help come to you. This sounds like how some of us start our day, not the other way. Like, Pastor, now I can agree with you. This is how I start my day. Bang, bang, bang. Let my cry for help come to you. Verse 2. Do not hide your face from me when I am in distress. Turn your ear to me when I call. Answer me quickly. Now, you don't have to be ashamed about this, because I'm going to raise my hand first. Does this sound like any of our prayers? Yeah, my soul magnifies the Lord. I only do that on Sunday with you, okay? This is my Monday through Saturday prayer. I'm just taking the mask right off. Sunday, I put the suit on today, right? Sunday, I put the suit on. It's like, my soul magnifies. But I'm going to give you a heads up on Monday. Lord, hear my cry. Why are you so far from me? Oh, something like that. Verse 2. Do not hide your face from me when I am in distress. Turn your ear to me when I call. Answer me quickly. Not even done there. Verse 3. For my days vanish like smoke and my bones burn like glowing embers. My heart is what? Wow. My heart is blighted and withered like grass. I forget to eat my food. Not me when I'm depressed, I eat. I forget to eat my food. Well, we're all different. Come on, get on track here. We're reading the Word of God. Come on, where's my hand? Okay, where are we? Because of my loud groaning, I am reduced to skin and bones. We can go on. I am like a desert owl. Really? I am like a desert owl, like an owl among the ruins. I lay awake. I have become like a bird alone on a roof. I'm glad you're still laughing. All day long. How about this, guys? All day long, my enemies taunt me. Those who rail against me use my name as a curse. For I eat ashes as my food and mingle my drink with tears. We've all been there. Amen to that. We've all been there. Uh-huh. Because of your great wrath. You see, our God is an angry God because we see our life as miserable. For you have taken me up and thrown me aside. Has he really? Has he really?
No.
I know it feels like it, but has he?
No.
No! My days are like the evening shadow. I wither away like grass. Some of you want me to stop? There's going to be two more verses here. One more. For you, O Lord, sit enthroned forever. Okay. Your renown endures through all the generations. So stop there. At least there's a button there, huh? For you, O Lord. Huh. Look at verse 10. Because of your great wrath, for you have taken me and thrown me aside. Listen. When you and I are in our right mind, we know that's not true. When we're in our right minds, We know that our God is not angry with us and he has not thrown us to the side. But we feel like that sometimes, don't we? We feel like that. And when we feel like that, man in a fallen place will take his soul and marry it to his feelings and then become an expression of what he feels. I feel like this, therefore we declare with our mouths, this is who I am and this is how I will live. I am cast aside and my God is angry with me. My days are useless, and I have developed a speech impediment because of my woe and my sorrow. Yeah. I want us to see. Listen, there is a plan of salvation. I want us to see Psalm 24, Psalm 102 does precede Psalm 103 and 104 and 105. Psalms 104 on are called the great Hallel Psalms. Hallel. Hallel. And we said in Revelation 19, when there was the fourfold hallelujahs, we know hallelujah is just the Hebrew word for praise the Lord. Hallel means praise. Yah is the Lord. Hallelujah is coming. Praise God. Lord. Huh. God wants to save your soul because he loves you. And the way that God is going to save your soul is to tell you, let your soul no longer be married to the dead old man and be an expression of the earth and everything that you think, see, and feel. He says you need to be married to the heavenly realm, which is why you were birthed. You were birthed to be the physical creation representation of the heavens. So when somebody wanted to know what God and heaven looked like, they would look into your eyes and your life and get the full understanding of what heaven and God looks like. Can I get a witness from anyone?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let me ask you a question. Is God ever tired or worn out? No. Scripture says he never slumbers nor sleeps. Right? Is God ever weak or depressed?
No.
Is God ever a failure? Is God ever given up? No. That means you're not, because you are the physical representation of him. Therefore, your soul must stop agreeing with the old man. The salvation of your soul is when your soul stops agreeing with the earthly realm and starts agreeing with the heavenly realm, and you say what God says. You were intended to be a physical representation of this earth, of God in heaven. And if it does not appear, it's only because you haven't showed up yet in your right mind. Because any time, any place you show up in your right mind, you bring God and you bring heaven. You bring glory and you bring life and light. You bring joy and you bring peace. Can I get a witness, please?
Amen.
Yeah. Because your soul lines up with something that's invisible. I know the invisible realm says, cry out to God quickly. But the invisible realm says, just praise the Lord because everything is fine. So when I look into the invisible realm, my soul starts to say, my soul magnifies the Lord. When I wake up in the morning, I say, a new day is dawning. My soul will sing its song. My soul, bless the Lord, Pastor Phil. Oh, my soul, finish it for me. And all that is within me, do what? Bless his holy name. Why? Why? Because of what Psalm 105 just said. Why? Okay, listen back and think again. Why we bless the Lord? Because of his wonderful acts, that's why. Because of his wonderful name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. Look at verse 5. What's the first word in verse 5? Somebody shout it out.
Remember.
Remember. Come on. Sometimes you got to come and remember. Remember what? Remember the wonders he has done. Does anybody remember how good your God is? Remember his miracles. Remember the judgments that he pronounced upon your enemies that shout out to you. They're already doomed and destroyed. Amen. 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 This is the salvation of your soul and my soul. I know that this is where God is bringing us to. God wants to save your soul. And this, by title of today's message, is the wisdom of God. This is the wisdom of God. If you would, if you want, turn to the 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The wisdom of God. I want to read a few verses, so if you don't have any Bibles, I don't mind reading to you if you don't mind listening. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18. Listen. 1:18. For the message of the cross is foolishness only to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is what? The power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. The intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? Listen to this. For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Verse 22, if you're following. Jews demand miraculous signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential, not many were noble or of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. How about that? He chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are. So that not one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us once again the wisdom of God. That is our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let him who boasts, boast in the Lord. Amen. What might seem foolish in the eyes of man is the very wisdom and salvation of God. Amen. You hear that? I don't care what your earth cries out to you. I don't care what the earth cries out to you. I don't know what you wake up to sometimes on a Monday or a Tuesday morning that wants to take the heavens from you. But I tell you this, it's the wisdom of man, but it's the foolishness of God. God wants you to rise up in his wisdom, in his strength, in his life, and speak to those things. He wants to rise you up to things that the world say have no significance and no power. He wants to rise you up from your weak place. He wants to rise you up from your dying place, from your place where you think I don't matter so much or life doesn't really have much joy or peace to me. He wants to rise you up from that place and cause everything else to fall before you. He wants you to be married to the spirit realm and say the Psalms in Psalm 103 and 104 where you wake up in the morning, maybe on a Monday through a Saturday, and you say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Do not forget his benefits, for he is wonderful. He is counselor. He is the mighty God. He is the Prince of Peace. He is your God, and he is my God. Whatever seems to be strong and real to you, if it comes against the word of God, it's foolishness. It's weak. It's nothing compared to the invisible realm of God that you were sent to manifest. Doesn't that excite you? That excites me. It excites me to say that we have the privilege to go into something where we may be thought the fool to say anything other than what seems to be so obvious. You know? And we say, well, I don't care what seems to be so obvious that's all around me. I'm going to tell you something about something that's invisible that will overcome and overtake what seems to be so obvious. I love that. Right? Amen. God shows you. He called your name. That's why you're here today. He woke you up this morning and he breathed his breath of life into you. He says, you're my son and you're my daughter. He says, today, as always, I want you to be the representation of me. I want you to be the representation of heaven, of light, and of love. And you rise up with a new song and you say, my soul magnifies the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. How do you bring to nothing all these things that are your enemies? You ignore them. Really? You ignore them. You stop giving them your life.
Amen.
And you be the expression of God. The more you shout hallelujah, let me tell you something. The more you shout hallelujah, the less you'll shout God save
you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The more you shout praise the Lord, the less you'll say, God, hear my cry. I want you to have an understanding. God wants to take you from a place to God, hear my cry. And he wants you to bring you to a place and then listen. He wants to bring you into somebody else's world. Can we get out of your world for a second now? Is that all right?
Yes.
Is that all right?
Yes.
He wants you to bring you into somebody else's world. Maybe it's your wife or your husband or your child or your nephew or your friend or whomever. He wants you to bring you into somebody else's world who's saying, Lord, hear my cry. He wants you to go into their world. Give them a hallelujah.
Yes.
Give them a hallelujah. Is that all right, church?
Yes.
Amen. Stand with me. Praise team, come forward. Build me 10,000 reasons. All those. Pastor Phil, I'll need your Bible again. I should finish giving me my grades on my report card. Yeah. Psalm 104 and 105. Listen. A new day is dawning. A new day is dawning. You have read Psalm 102? Turn the page. Turn the page. It ain't over yet. Turn the page. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me.
Bless his holy name.